Happy holidays, everyone. Welcome to another Speed Drawing with Fauntroy Comics. And today we're going to be learning the true history of Santa Claus. That's right, everyone. Jolly old Saint Nick. We're going to learn the true and actual history of jolly old Saint Nick. But before I continue, I'm going to stop so you could hit that like and subscribe button so you could see more of my stuff on your timeline. Now I'm waiting. There we go. All right, so we're going to learn some more about jolly old Saint Nick, and I hope you enjoy, you know, what I'm working on. So Santa Claus, otherwise known as Saint Nicholas or Kris Kringle, has a long history steeped in Christmas traditions. Today, he is thought of mainly as the jolly man in red who brings toys to good girls and boys on Christmas Eve. But his story stretches all the way back to the 3rd century when Saint Nicholas walked the earth and became the patron saint of children. Creepy. Find out more about the history of Saint Nicholas through his earliest origins to the shopping mall Santas of today, and discover how two New Yorkers, I really hope he had a nickname. Clement Clark Moore and Thomas Nast were major influences on Santa Claus. Millions of children wait for Christmas Eve. The legend of Saint Santa Claus can be traced back hundreds of years ago to a monk named Saint Nicholas. It is believed that Saint Nicholas was born sometime around 280 AD in Patara, near Myra in modern-day Turkey. Much admired for his piety and kindness, look that one up, Saint Nicholas became the subject of many legends. It is said that he gave away all of his inherited wealth and traveled the countryside helping the poor and sick. One of the best known St. Nicholas stories is the time he saved three poor sisters from being sold into slavery or prostitution by their father by providing them with a dowry so that they could be married. I mean, they could have done it OnlyFans, but you know, whatever. I'm not here to judge. Over the course of many years, Nicholas's popularity spread and he became as the protector of children and sailors. That is really creepy. His feast day is celebrated on the anniversary of his death, December 6th, actually. This was traditionally considered a lucky day to make large purchases or get married. By the Renaissance, Saint Nicholas was the most popular saint in Europe. Even after the Protestant Reformation, when the veneration of saints began, the discouraged Saint Nicholas maintained a positive reputation, especially in Holland. So before I continue, yes, you say today I'm working on a it's hard to really describe it. I'm not going to describe it. Don't worry about it. So Sinterklaas, S-I-N-T-E-R K-L-A-A-S, comes to New York. Saint Nicholas made his first inroads in America and American pop culture towards the end of the 18th century in December 1773 and again in 1774. A New York newspaper reported the groups of Dutch families had gathered to honor the anniversary of his death. The name Santa Claus evolved from Nick's Dutch name Sinterklaas, a shortened form of Saint Nicholas, Dutch for Saint Nicholas, of course. In 1804, John Petard, a member of the New York Historical Society, distributed woodcuts of Saint Nicholas at the Society's annual meeting. The background of the engraving contains now familiar Santa images including the stockings filled with toys, fruit hung from over a fireplace. I don't want my fruit hanging over the fireplace. I'm glad they stopped that. In 1809, Washington Irving helped to popularize the Santa Claus stories when he referred to St. Nicholas as the patron saint of New York in his book, The History of New York. As his prominence grew, Santa Claus was described as everything as from a rascal with a blue three-cornered hat, red waistcoat, and yellow stockings to a man wearing a broad-brimmed hat and a huge pair of Flemish trunk hose. What the heck is that? All right, beat switch. So I've taken my drawing from Photoshop over to Manga Studio. I haven't messed with Manga Studio in a while. I know some people call it Clip Studio Paint, but you know, when I got it, it was Manga Studio, so I'm gonna just keep calling it that. But it sucks having to bring it over here just for the sake of inking it and some of the features that Photoshop is missing. It's a pain in the butt to have to do it, but it's still fun to mess around with. As you can see, I just finished, I'm actually probably still inking it, depending on, you know, how fast this thing is moving. But I also am using one of its shape features, which it has a really good library on shape features that this is actually my first time really using it for her lace. I'm working on the lace for her stockings, but again, you know, it's some features that this program has and some features that this program doesn't have. Same thing with Photoshop. I really don't want to come across as crapping on just Manga Studio and not Photoshop, because Photoshop is missing a bunch of stuff too. I really love Clip Studio for its its vector. I guess you could say vector. I don't know. For the auto correction and the smoothing features that it has for inking and for brushes. Photoshop doesn't have it. It's a plugin for Photoshop, and I don't feel like running a plugin every time I, you know, want to ink something. So sometimes I would just bring it over to Clip Studio and just clean it up real quick and then bring it back. It sucks, but you know, whatever. What can you do? Oh, so let me stop right now. Right now I'm actually using a mesh texture that I found online. Yes, it's no shame to, you know, it's no shame to do this if you don't feel like going through all of this to, you know, to create textures like that, okay? And this is actually my first time really using textures in a long time. So that being said, it's, you know, I don't care. You can judge me. Need your judgment. All right, gift giving, mainly centered around children, has been an important part of Christmas celebration since the holiday's rejuvenation in the early 19th century. Stores began to advertise Christmas shopping in 1820, and by the 1840s, newspapers were creating separate sections for holiday advertisements, which often features images of the newly popular Santa Claus. In 1841, thousands of children visited Philadelphia shop to see a life-size Santa Claus model. Okay. It was only a matter of time before stores began to attract children and their parents with the lure of a peek at live Santa Claus. In the early 1890s, the Salvation Army, needed money to pay for the free Christmas meals they provided to needy families. They began dressing up unemployed men in Santa Claus suits and sending them to the streets of New York City to solicit donations. Those familiar Salvation Army Santas have been ringing bells on the streets of the American cities ever since. Perhaps the most iconic department store Santa is Kris Kringle. I didn't know that was a different guy. I thought it was the same guy. In the 1947 classic Santa Claus movie, Miracle on 34th Street, a young Natalie Wood played a little girl who believes Kris Kringle, played by Edmund Gwynn, I don't need to know any of these people, who won an Oscar. God. When he says he is the real Santa Claus. Miracle on 34th Street was remade in 1994 and starred, oh Lord, Lord Richard Attenborough and Mara Wilson. The Macy's Santa has appeared at almost every Macy's Thanksgiving parade since it began in 1924. All right, back to it. Let's skip that. Yes, 'twas the night before Christmas. In 1822, Clement Clark Moore, an Episcopal minister, wrote a long Christmas poem for his three daughters entitled An Account of a Visit from St. Nicholas. More popularly, known as 'Twas the Night Before Christmas. Moore's poem, which he was initially hesitant to publish due to the frivolous nature of its subject, is largely responsible for our modern image of Santa Claus as a right jolly old elf with a portly figure and a supernatural ability to ascend a chimney with a mere nod of his head. Imagine you asking for your superpowers and the motherfuckers just give you the ability to just ascend chimneys. Specifically chimneys. Nothing else. Just chimneys. Just by nodding your head. I would be pissed. I'm like, bro, like I live in an apartment. Alright, let me get back to it. I'm sorry. Although some of Moore's imagery was probably borrowed from the other sources, his poem helped popularize the now familiar image of Santa Claus, who flew from house to house on Christmas Eve in a miniature sleigh led by 8 flying reindeer to leave presents for deserving children. An account of a visit from St. Nicholas created a new and immediately popular American icon. In 1881, political cartoonist Thomas Nast drew on Moore's poem to create the first likeness that matches our modern image of Santa. His cartoon, which appeared in Harper's Weekly, depicted Santa as a rotund, cheerful man with a full white beard, holding a sack laden with toys for lucky children. It is Nast who gave Santa his bright red suit trimmed with white fur and a North Pole workshop, elves, his wife, Mrs. Claus. Alright, so another beat switch. I had a really rough day yesterday and today. It was horrible. I ain't gonna front. It was horrible. So that's why, you know, this video was supposed to come out yesterday, but it ended up coming out today. So, yeah. But anyways, back to whatever this is, because that just put me down. All right, so Santa Claus and his wife, Mrs. Claus, call the North Pole home, and children write letters to Santa and track Santa's progress around the world on Christmas Eve. How do they track his progress? You think they have like a package tracker? Like, you know how like Amazon has a package tracker? What if Amazon got the package tracker technology from Santa Claus? So they was ahead of the curve. Okay. I see you, Jeff Bezos. All right, so children often leave cookies and milk for Santa and cares for his reindeer on Christmas Eve. Santa Claus keeps a naughty list and a nice list to determine who deserves gifts for Christmas morning. And parents often invoke these lists as a way to ensure the children are on their best behavior. The lists are immortalized in the 1934 Christmas song, Santa Claus is Coming to Town. Remix. He's making a list. He's checking it twice. He's going to find out who's naughty or be prepared to fight. He sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. And if you've been bad, be prepared for this fate. Okay, that's not the exact words, but you see where I'm going with this. Rudolph, the most famous reindeer of all. Why is he famous? Just because he has a red nose? He's been snorting coke. Like, how is that making him special? But anyways, was born over 100 years after his 8 flying counterparts. Think about it. The new dude is the one that gets famous. You only been on the team for like 2 years. Now you famous. Okay. Like, we haven't been doing anything. All right, whatever. The red nose wonder. Okay, y'all. Okay. All right, I'm back to it. Wonder was the creation of Robert L. May, a copywriter at the Montgomery Ward department store. I remember Montgomery Wards. Jesus Christ. Okay. In 1939, May wrote a Christmas-themed story poem to help bring holiday traffic into his store, using a similar rhyme pattern to Moore's 'Twas the Night Before Christmas. May told the story of Rudolph, a young reindeer who was teased by the others for snorting coke. I'm sorry. No. I'm sorry. Let me actually stick to the story. He was teased by the other reindeer because of his large, glowing red nose. Coke. But when Christmas Eve turned foggy, and Santa worried that he wouldn't be able to deliver the gifts that night, the former outcast saved Christmas by leading the sleigh by the light of his red nose. Rudolph's message, that given the opportunity, a liability can be turned into an asset, and proved popular. How did he pitch that to 10-year-olds? Okay, they're going to have to Google asset or look it up. Montgomery Ward sold almost 2.5 million copies of the story in 1939. When it was reissued in 1946, the book sold over 3.5 million copies. Several years later, one of May's friends, Johnny Marks, wrote a short song based on Rudolph's story. It was recorded by Gene Autry and sold over 2 million copies. Since then, the story has been translated into 25 different languages and been made into a television movie narrated by Burl Ives. Where do y'all get these names? Which was charmed audiences ever since 1964. From his Puritan roots to complaints of rampant commercialism. What is it you want, Charlie Brown? Asked Lucy in Charlie Brown's Christmas. Real estate. Imagine a 10-year-old asking for real estate. Jeez, ahead of the curve. Christmas in America has been filled with traditions, old and new. Some date back to 16th century Germany or even ancient Greek times, while others have caught on in modern times. Here's a look at 25 ways Americans have celebrated the Christmas season, from singing songs and reciting poems to decorating trees and swapping cookies to drinking eggnogs, ugh, and wearing ugly sweaters. I should do voice acting. I think that'll be dope. Christmas trees, decorated trees date back to Germany in Middle Ages, with Germany and other European settlers popularizing Christmas trees in America by the early 19th century. A New York woodsman named Mark Carr is credited with opening the first U.S. Christmas tree lot in 1851. So this fool just collected a bunch of trees, put it in the lot, and just like, hell, it's gonna catch on at some point. Wow. A 2019 survey by the American Christmas Tree Association predicted that 77% of U.S. households displayed a Christmas tree in their home. Among the trees on display, an estimated 81% were artificial and 19% were real. That's good. I like to hear that. Despite how much I love traditional trees and I love real trees and the smell of it and all of that stuff, I think it really sucks that we just, you know, for a month of every year, a lot of us just go out, you know, not go outside, but, you know, someone goes into a forest somewhere and just hack down a tree and decide to decorate it and then throw it away once it's dried out. Like, you know, we got to do better on that. But, you know, whatever. That's another story for another day. The Rockettes. Since 1925, first known as the Missouri Rockettes, this iconic dance troupe has been kicking up its heels, officially becoming the Radio City Music Hall Rockettes in 1934. From performing at movie openings to entertaining troops to making TV appearances, they're perhaps best known for their annual Christmas spectacular. I have never heard of the Rockettes. That's something that y'all will have to educate me on. Ooh, my favorite. A Charlie Brown Christmas. Decades later, it may be hard to imagine that this beloved TV special inspired the Charles Schulz Peanuts comic strip was first rejected by CBS executives. But when it finally aired on December 9th, 1965, almost half of all U.S. TV sets were tuned to the broadcast. And the show went on to win an Emmy, a Peabody, and during following even a trend of Charlie Brown Christmas trees. I never thought it was such a bad little tree, Linus says in the special. I missed that show. That was one of my favorites. It's not bad at all, really. Maybe it just need a little love. Isn't that what we all need? Christmas pickles. What the hell is a Christmas pickle? If there's a pickle among your snowman, angel, and reindeer ornaments, you're likely taking part in the American tradition of hiding the green ornament on the tree so that the first child to find it wins a gift or gets to open the first present Christmas morning. Hiding the pickle? Are we really gonna go there? Okay, I'm sorry. I'm an adult. The practice's origins are a bit murky, or briny, shall I say, but it's likely it grew from a Woolworth marketing gimmick from the late 1800s when the retailer received imported German ornaments shaped like pickles and needed a sales pitch. Ooh. Have you heard of Elf on the Shelf? Well, I present to you Timmy on the Stimmy. Break down those stimulus checks, government. But anyways, Elf on the Shelf. Love it or loathe it, since 2005, moms and dads have either joyously or begrudgingly been hiding a toy elf each night from Thanksgiving to Christmas. More than 13 million elves have been adopted. I don't know if I like that. Adopted since 2005 when Carol, oh Lord, here's another name, Abersold and her daughter, Shonda Bell, published the book Elf on a Shelf, a Christmas tradition that comes with the toy. Social media has even inspired some parents to set up elaborate scenarios for their elves, as in He TP'd the tree. She filled the sink with marshmallows. Okay. The Yule log. Isn't the Yule log just wood? Okay. We'll see. Yule logs were part of ancient winter solstice celebrations, but it was Americans who turned the wood burning into must-see TV. Back in 1966, WPIX TV in the New York City aired a continuous 17-second loop of fireplace for 3 hours, along with holiday music. That led to an eventual better production and nearly 20 years of annual viewing. Today, you can view the Yule log on demand and on the web. In fact, History Channel offers its own Yule log theme to the series Forest and Fire. That's interesting. All right, everyone. I really hope you enjoyed this holiday special. I'm going to make another video actually explaining something about this actual drawing. So please don't worry. I'm going to give you another one so that, you know, you could actually, you know, learn something outside of just me rambling about Santa Claus. But hope you enjoy. See you on the next one. And don't forget to like and subscribe. All right.